trailer for sale or rent, rooms to let 50 cents, no phone, no pool, no pets, ain't got no cigarettes. Ah, but 2 hours of pushing broom buys a 8x12 4-bit room. I'm a man of means, by no means king of the road.
Okay, boys, it's showtime. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to our segment on old fools. No, excuse me, I meant old tools, all right? But you've seen these guys before. Jake Burridge over here, he's been on many times. I think last thing he was on, we were talking about rum running. Jimmy Giannakakis.
Giannakakis,
I always mess that up. You met Jimmy before down at Appleton Farms. We did a thing on old farming equipment. It was pretty interesting. But this has nothing to do with what we're really going to talk about here, but Jake surprised me this morning, and you often see this, don't tread on me, but go ahead. Is this official or not?
This is an official-looking flag. It's not the official flag. This was designated right after the turn of the 17th century, and it was a Navy ship flag. Uncle Sam's flag on the United States Navy. This flew in Tripoli and places like that. It is a legal American flag. It was then, and it is today. I flew this flag when I sailed across the ocean. I flew it in France, Canary Islands, Barbados, and back in the U.S. And you'd be surprised that the people want to know what it was. But however, this is an original, and it is legal today.
You gonna let me fly it on my boat this summer?
No.
Okay, this is called a cradle scythe. When they cut the hay or wheat or whatever it was, it didn't allow the wheat or hay to just lay there. It cradled it, and if you've seen the old pictures of the hay and stuff or the corn stalks tied up, that's what they did with this particular implement.
What do you think the age of this is? I mean,
200, maybe 150.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, what do you want to grab here?
This is a pitchfork that would pitch the hay or wheat or whatever onto the wagons. They come in various sizes and lengths. They're very good implement. They innovated them. They made them long and short for the particular use that they had for it.
Why do they only have three tines?
Well, three's better than two. They come in two.
Better than one.
It would hold more. Okay, here's another implement. It's a hedge trimmer. Activate it.
What?
Activate the hedge trimmer. That's it. Okay, you can see by the action, it's the concept hasn't changed, only it's been modified with electricity. So you won't have to kill yourself pumping in the thing.
I mean, literally hedge?
It's a hedge trimmer, right. You can see where the cutter ran along and the teeth.
Yeah.
It's just like the old-fashioned mowing machine, the horse-drawn mowing machine.
Wow.
The concept is there with these separators.
Yeah.
It brought the hay to a point where the cutter can slice it off.
So what are we talking about? What era of vintage or how many years old do you think?
I think it's turn of the century. It says...
Early 1900s?
Yeah, is any date on it?
No, it's built by Chandler and Air Mass.
Uh-huh. Here's an implement that is a strange, it's an innovation. I know these are hay knives. These two here had a handle where the hay used to settle, and when it settled, it was difficult to take the pitchfork and pitch it. So... this thing, we think, and we'd like the public, as you're looking at this, to give us an idea, we think it made the trenches on the marsh, because the marsh is hay. They cut it nice and straight, and they didn't have to do it twice. They did it one movement, would cut both sides, and then they'd lift it out with the shovels.
You mean like the canals that we see down in
The trenches out on the drainage trenches on the marsh.
I thought that was a WPA project. Somebody
told
me. Well, it was a WPA.
Yeah, it was. Yeah.
I think that was to keep the trenches straight in the marsh. Back in the WPA project, they cut trenches in the marsh to drain the marshes out, and that was probably made to cut alongside the trench that they were digging. And so much for that one. What else you got, Jim?
Tough to work.
Yeah. But that's
not
what.
Light.
No. But it was hard work, and there were rugged men in those days.
What are we, a bunch of panties?
Yes. This is an ANADS. ADZ.
This is yours.
Yeah. Okay. Well, maybe. It might end up here. I'm not sure. It's worth too much money to leave here. This is pretty old. It's hand-forged. Handle is one piece. See the curvature? See the curvature in the handle is one piece. This one made usually in shipbuilding. They could be swung on the side, but basically it was swung between the legs on beams that they would clean as before they put them up. It was a terrific tool and used many, many different ways.
Another thing over in Essex, or the shipbuilding.
Yeah, yep. And that's how they used them. So, okay, Jim, what you got?
All right, next.
These are sickles. They're designed to cut shrubs and hay on the property of the different people. Can you picture somebody cutting a big estate in England with a sickle? I don't know. It was quite a task.
Pretty sharp.
They are they?
Yeah.
All right. That's good. I've got one that's got a long handle on it. There's so many innovations to tools. Actually, the farm has been a big place where a lot of the inventions in this country were developed. So you can see.
I'm surprised how sharp they are.
Yeah, they have to be. Otherwise, you'd be working yourself to. Okay.
Jimmy, go ahead.
Kitty horse. It's a harness maker's vise. He used the pedal here to bring pressure to the jaws up here, and he'd work and stitch whatever he had to, whatever the design was, and that was the express purpose of this particular tool or mechanism.
What'd you do for exercise for the left leg?
These are metal shears. You can see the length of it and the strength of it. It was used to cut metal. I don't know how old it is, but it certainly isn't new, as you can see. Hold that. And she'd come in there, and it still works.
You can't buy that at Sears. Craftsman doesn't make it, right?
Craftsman doesn't make this tool. This was made before Craftsman. Anyway, so much for that metal cutter shears.
All right.
This is not so weird. It's a wagon jack. When the wagon wheels broke, or when the wheels needed greasing and they had to change the wheel, they'd jack it up. A lot of the wagon wheels would eventually wear out, especially the hubs. The hubs were made out of elm, this very strong wood, and that was the purpose of that, to get the wagon axle up high enough so they could change the wheel or do whatever maintenance they had to do.
You had
to call AAA. Yeah. I'm glad we're bringing a little humor to this. This is a broad axe. They come in different sizes and shapes. There's little ones that look like hatchets. There's other ones that are this size here. This is about the biggest one they make. This is a straight cutting broad axe. Some of them a straight on either left or right, according to what the workman, if he was left or right-handed, they accommodated that by making it flat so he could get close to the beams that he was trimming or whatever he had to do with this. Usually cutting a lot of wood, a lot of chips.
This is a small caulking iron. They use an iron like this when they caulk the seams in a ship or a boat. There's no handle on this, it's broken. And this was a very small one. The caulking iron was usually larger and not quite as sharp as this. But that was a caulk, this is a leftover caulking iron. It goes way back. I don't know how far back. That's just plain old.
You should go after Paul with that.
It's a wooden mallet. They use that for a thousand things. In other words, they didn't use a steel mallet to hit the back of a cutter or anything that would have to be driven, but not to use a metal of it. It's a drive.
What the devil is this thing? Keep the mic up there. No, you.
I have no idea. It looks like a shredder or a separator, or it probably separated the wheat from the chaff. I don't know. If anyone out there has any idea, it isn't identified. I can't identify it, and if somebody would appreciate it.
These are beam log hooks. When they haul their beams around, these hooks were tied down. As you can see, they're old, heavy, and strong. And they would hook the log this way, and you get the log down, and the log rest in the middle. And you could haul them, pick them up, and use them for cutting, so you could pull a log into the sawmill and do the cutting by the log. It was a tool to assist the man working on the saws, and that's what that was all about. This is a branding iron they used to brand the natives once in a while when they figured they wanted them, kept them nearby so they would brand them.
It could have been branded though, like for pieces of
equipment, yeah, that they would brand with an iron like this. There's one here, the smallest one, does have a nice name on it. Read it backwards.
It's bad. It's like you need a mirror image.
Yes. Anyway, the numbers are here, and if you read them backwards, it says something. I can't read it. They're a little diffused. The bottom one in particular has larger numbers. But there again, they're pretty well faded.
All right, what have we got here?
All right, this is a cheese press. We have two of them. We have there's three of them here. If you want to bring them out, they're heavy.
That's all right.
It's too bad we couldn't get in there. They put a lever in there, turned it, and this drew the thing up by the ropes, drew this up, and press the cheese to eliminate the excess water out of it.
Like a block of cheese?
Yeah.
What do you think the vintage of this is?
It's
1800s?
Oh, yeah, at least. Maybe late 17. It's a real old-timer. There's no steel in it.
The trunnels?
Pegs.
Pegs?
Dowels, so to speak.
What makes a peg different from a trunnel?
A peg is like a round thing, looks like a peg. That's what a peg is.
Yeah.
A trunnel is a squarer thing that could fit in to a round hole. Let's put it that way. Yeah. And it would be driven in. It would be more.
I thought you couldn't put a square into a round hole.
Oh, well, when you drove it in, it had more holding power.
Okay.
Because the edge of the square would flake.
Ooh,
This is a buck saw. Now, this is an older one. Today, you see these younger buck saws.
Don't you cut me.
I won't. As you can see, the blade fits in the bottom. It's the newer ones to do today. But this one here has the section here doweled in.
Get that mic up there.
These sections
here. I want to hear your golden voice.
Okay. So anyway, the blade is still an old blade, as you can see. One row of teeth. The newer buck saws would have two rows of teeth, a larger tooth and a smaller tooth. A smaller tooth would be used to clear the wood. This one here had slots that would make were made for a bigger blade. You could either deeper or smaller.
Yeah.
As you can see, where it was fastened here, and it was doweled in here, and the top here had a circular beam that would
turnbuckle.
Right. It would you could bring it in tight. And today they don't have a turnbuckle. It comes fastened, and that's what it is. You have no choice after that. So this is an oldie, probably goes back 100 years or more than 100 years, probably 150 years at least.
This place is becoming like the clown car at the circus. I mean, stuff keeps coming out here.
Look at that. Didn't know what that was.
It lay on it.
Oh, yeah. They're like with the fire readers, those type of guys.
But that's for stripping rush. They take rush and they strip it, don't they? They take wool.
They put this in the middle road when get a flat tire. I don't know what that was for. No. But anyway, it goes back a few years because
they take wool and do something with the wool. That's what I think.
Yeah, well, they had two pins that set up on something.
Oh, come here.
An upholsterer's tack hammer. For upholstering, they use very small tacks, and you've got a good hook on the other end of it. I've seen more modern ones. This one here is quite old, but you can see where it was pretty well bent. But they had a little hook to pull their tacks out if they misjudged them.
Here's a steel square. A steel square. This is a wooden steel square. It's all wood.
Really?
The original steel square came from this. They made sure that it was perfect, it was fastened, and it was made of wood.
What type of wood? It looks hard.
It was, I don't know, so dirty you couldn't tell what it was. But they called this, instead of a steel square, they called it a tri-square. The steel square came out. It was larger and more perfect, had markings on it so you could read it.
There are concepts the same. I mean, I got one myself.
Did you use
not
it?
A wood.
However, this is the original layout for the steel square that we see today. That's enough. What do you got? What do you got, Jim?
This is a spirit level. It tests a horizontal and vertical plane. It's a heavy piece of equipment. The bubbles are still working. It may be accurate, but you have to test them to make sure. Anytime you buy one of these, you should always test it. And you can test it by running this way and this way to see if the lines match, this way and this way to see if the lines run in the proper direction. If there's anything off, that means the level isn't working properly. This is the way to test it. Once this way and that way, by making lines and put it on the line. Huh?
What's that hole for? Or is that, that's one of the bubbles.
Oh, that's one of the bubbles, yes.
So that's something that's pretty much the same.
Yeah, this looks like it's walnut, the wood.
No, but you know what I mean? I mean, the concept, you go down to Tetford's, it'll be metal but it'll, or plastic, or but it will look like that. It'll operate like that. All right.
This is a set of outside calipers, and I'm telling you, they are really old. They've been cast, or forged rather, and worked on. They're not as precision as the ones they make today that can measure to the thousandths. They serve the purpose. They measure between these two points by taking the thumb screw and opening and closing it and transferring this dimension to a turning on the lathe or a spindle or a post, and you could change it to accommodate the different designs on a turning on a lathe.
This is a marking gauge. It's an old wooden marking gauge. You unscrew the top here, which is a wood screw. You could adjust it on a board, slide it back and forth.
Demonstrate. Well, anyway, this little nib here cut a mark as you went along. This wrote against whatever you wanted. It would make the parallel lines so you could work with it with a plane or a saw, and you'd have an accurate piece of stock.
I get it. I see it. Mm-hmm. Scribe.
So scribe. Well, same idea as a scribe, right?
Keep that baby up there.
Call this a grub hole. This is a little bit old. You have one today, the modern little grub hole. It's got the three tines. Today they have the four tines and the edge, which is wider. As you can see, this one here had a pretty heavy iron tongs to cut the grass with, and still this edge here was fairly sharp. So you
grass?
No.
What are you cutting? What was it for?
It's a grub hole to work in the bottom to dig up weeds.
Oh, okay.
And turn it around and more weeds.
So it's a cousin of the adz, in a way.
Well, no. Well,
it looks like it.
No, that was just mostly for working in the ground. It's a grub hole that worked in the ground. That's what it was for.
All right. Here we go.
These are draw knives.
I know what this is.
As you can see, these again come in various sizes. There's a round one, and there's two straight ones. This is an 8. And that's a 7, and they were designed, as you can see, to form the wood. Nothing is always perfectly flat and square. They put like a chair. They probably scoop out a chair with this one here for the seat part. And they like I said, they come in various designs.
Is that what today we'd call a spoke shave?
Spoke shave?
Yeah, you ever heard of a
spoke shave? Is different. I don't know if we have one. Yeah.
But it says the principle's the same.
Principle's the same. You're drawing a spoke shave,
yeah.
And they were predominantly designed for the spokes on our wagons. That's why they call it spoke shave.
Hey, Jake, what do you got back there?
My brother Phil. We lived on Topsfield Road, and he had a carriage like this. And for some reason or another, he ran across the street pushing the carriage, and the car came down and hit him. Knocked him over, he ended up in the hospital. The carriage never got hurt. It was newer than this, it's really old. This carriage goes back like this. But anyway, he got hit in the hospital, carriage went across the road. We saved the carriage. My mother went to the hospital with him. We lived on Topsfield Road, the house was empty. People came in from all over, walking through the house, and old Tom Christopher came down, and he looks around and he says, "What are you people doing? Get out of this house." He drove them all out. Give Tom credit. We didn't know who those people were. They came from all over town. A house to go through, right? And they did. But Tom Christopher, he saved the day. He drove them out. I was only a kid, too. He did a good job. Old Tom Christopher, yeah.
These are called radius planes. As you can see, the bottoms are curved, and they were designed to accommodate a curve at this particular arc. They were both, that's what the blade is recessed on that one, and that one's recessed. I'm glad to see that, because today, my shop teacher would never allow a blade to be extended and the plane put on a bench. He says, you lay it on its side, and if you're not using it, retract the blade. And this has been done. It's
what
great.
What would you use this on, like a wheel
well,
or something?
Well, you'd use it, say you were making a valance.
Yeah.
And there was a curve in it.
Yeah.
And you sawed it, right?
Yeah.
And there's saw marks in it. You'd smooth it out with this. Incidentally, you don't go right across the arc. You hit it from both ends so you won't chip out, because if you ran it, you'd chip the other side. So you hit it from both sides.
I got
you. Yep.
All right.
They have these also that you can adjust for various arcs. And I have one at home. I should have brought it, yeah.
This is an old, called a joiner plane. Called a joiner plane because of the length of the thing. It gave you a good, long cut, smooth cut, and it's a wooden one, as you can see. Today, they make a joiner plane out of steel. It's shorter than this, but it's still a long plane. It's got a wooden handle here, cracked.
Yeah, we know.
And the blade fit into there behind that wooden peg. They don't have the blade in this one.
Whoop.
But
oh, that's the thing that keeps the blade.
That keeps the blade in.
Okay.
But they don't have one.
Right.
They had a piece of wood to hold it together.
I got you.
So anyway, this plane is
what do you think the age is on that?
This plane's going to be quite old, I would say.
1800s?
In the 1800s. It goes way back and see what some of the wormholes are in it. See the little wormhole?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
They, look at here, all little wormholes.
Wow.
So, this.
It seemed better days. These are called bit braces, and these are called drill bits. As you can see, you can take them out. The tang is square, so it locks in there. And you simply mark a spot, put the drill against it, and turn it. And it's supposed to make a hole for you. But don't always drill through a piece of wood. It could split out the other end. When the screw shows on the other end, you come the other way, and you'll have a neat hole. And that's what these are.
Well, these lasted pretty much, I mean.
Huh?
I have one of these in my cellar.
Yeah.
That's a modern version.
Yeah.
But people still use them, right? Or mostly powered.
Yeah, everything's powered today. If you were way out in the woods somewhere and you didn't have any electricity, you'd have to resort to one of these.
Okay.
Some people do everything the old-fashioned way. Just. And they come in various sizes. There'll be a number on the tang. This is a number 5. Can you see it? I can't. This way?
Yeah, we'll go with 5. Just
all right. That means it's 5/16 of an inch in diameter from these cutting edges. Okay?
Gotcha.
Flutes, tangs. So that's what a bit brace is about.
All right, man, we got another. Come on out here, Jake, get in the light.
This is a jack plane, a second cousin to the joiner. As you can see, it's shorter. It has a blade in it which comes through here, and the blade is wedged in with a wooden peg here. It's just as old as that joiner. As you can see, she's an old piece of wood, and it was made for shorter strokes, and that's why they called it a jack plane. And they'd use it for closer quarters where you couldn't use a joiner, and it was probably made way back in, I would say, early 1800s. It goes way back. This piece of wood is old.
Did they always use the same type wood? Or obviously, it was a hardwood.
It was a hardwood. They always used a good hardwood. Yeah. This could be ash. Got a nice straight grain. It would be ash or something like that, but it's heavy. The handle one isn't broken on this one. The handle on the other one was broken, and this was one piece. You can see where they use a hammer to drive it through, and she gets stuck. Hammer marks. So to get in there and get stuck, so they hit it and drive it through, and the blade would do the cutting.
All right, this is the finale.
You know, okay. This is called an egg beater drill, hand drill.
I got one of those. I got one of those in my cellar.
Have you? Well, They're good to have on hand when you can't get, find it and you don't have a long enough cord. You can always use this. They have an innovation. They're not really old. I don't know if I can open this, but...
Oh, you keep the bits in there?
The bits were in here, but there's none in this one. They were donated to the museum, and they served a purpose. Apparently, the handle is gone on this. It could be fixed. It doesn't turn very easily. It doesn't turn at all because it's frozen.
This is an antique, really. The screwdriver is on this end, and one size nut would fit on this end, just one. Looks like maybe it was made for a Model T Ford because it's one nut and one screwdriver. And that's how we repair the Model T, a wrench like this, a hammer, and coat hangers. That would fit any Model T Ford. And I believe this came from Model T by the looks of it.
All right, stay right there. Jimmy, get out of here. They won't quit. Okay, this is the last one.
Drawing knife scoop. You can see what this will accomplish by pulling this. Again, it might be a chair maker's scoop or whatever was needed to be rounded concave.
All right. We got more junk back
there.
That's enough. I agree.
What I want to do is I want to thank you, gentlemen. And let's bring up a little round of applause for these guys.
Yes, do that little thing. There we go.
All right, that's enough. That's enough.
Cut the applause. Okay.
Stay tuned. These guys will be back on the show sometime soon. Okay. So we'll see you. I got a great joke, Bob, but I will have to do it off air.
Off air. Okay.
The knights used a thing called the broadaxe. No.
That was the battle axe.
Battle axe. I thought that was a name for a woman who was...
An old battle axe.
No phone, no pool, no pets. Give me a heck of a neck.
Open it up. That's enough. Slide it. For crying out, or give it to Jimmy. He can handle it.
Move, I said, Jimmy. I won't. No, I can't. Son of a gun. It's been
raining, Jake. Don't. Yeah, don't. We don't want to get sued by the museum.
See my flag. God damn, you're going to rip the end of it. No. Handle it carefully. We're going to hold that flag up.
Yeah, I'm going to. Just the beginning here.
Okay. Got no cigarettes, but 2 hours.